rollen die Tom-Toms, rollen die Tom-Toms, rollen, rollen, verhecken das Blut.
Hello and good evening. My name is Kirill Gerstein, and you've tuned into Kirill Gerstein Invites, an online forum hosted by Kronberg Academy. And we're gathered here regularly, virtually. Your questions and participation is what makes this forum the live event it is. It's not just the recording on YouTube. So your questions are welcome, your comments are welcome in the chat box or in the Q&A, and I'll pass them along to Antony. Antony Beaumont is our guest this evening, and Antony is someone with many aspects to his creative life. He is a conductor, violinist, writer of very important and excellent books, translator, editor of music. So it's a thrill to be welcoming him here today. And he'll talk about one of his concentration points about the music, the life, the work, and I think some more hidden aspects of Alexander Zemlinsky. I first came to know Antony's books through his excellent volumes on Ferruccio Busoni, about whose life and compositions he wrote and whose letters he translated, as well as one of the often used completions of the incomplete, unfinished opera by Busoni, the Dr. Faustus. But here we are to talk about Zemlinsky, and we just heard a unpublished recording that Antony sent me from Baltimore Symphony, 1964, an African-American singer, a German-Jewish conductor who, as I understand, was a student of Zemlinsky. So a terrific departure point. Welcome, Antony.
Thank you, Kirill, for that introduction. It's good to be with you, and I hope I can be of some use to people in a little voyage of discovery around Alexander Zemlinsky. What I would like to do is, first of all, give a sort of rundown of his life and works, concentrating on the early years, and so that you don't have to look at my mug all the time. I've got a few nice photographs and some music to play in between. And then I will accelerate a bit through his through the middle of his career, because I think anybody can read it up in Wikipedia or in a good dictionary. There's plenty of literature nowadays, and maybe I'll just enumerate then the biggest works, the works that one should look out for those who don't know them already. I'm aware that we have some people listening in tonight or watching in tonight who know Zemlinsky very well, and I'm sure that there are other people who are all anxious to find out and don't know so much. So I'll try to, shall we speak to both sides of the house. And then when we got through that, which we hope will take about an hour or so, I would like to actually come to the point of this this seminar, which I chose the choice Alexander and his search for good fortune. Now, good fortune is a bad translation, or a wordy translation, for the German word Glück. You can say fortuna in Latin or Italian, you can say le bonheur, but the English luck is, to me, rather, it has so many different aspects, so many shades. If you say fortune, it sounds as if you're looking for money. If you say luck, it means maybe that you're winning on the lottery. If you say happiness, it sounds like you're just looking for a good family life, a quiet, you know, quiet existence. But this Glück is a sort of, it combines them all, and it has a certain cosmological aspect about it. You're talking about happiness in the sense of finding fulfillment, nirvana, finding something you can really believe in, something to hold firmly. I will explain just in this forefront that Zemlinsky gave up his religion when he was about 26 years old, and spent actually the rest of his life looking for something to replace it. He became a Freemason in the 1898, but we haven't been able to find very much out about that, for the simple reason that the Freemasons are a secret society and they're very good at keeping their secrets. But we do know that he was a Freemason, that he continued to be member of a Masonic lodge to the end of his time in Europe, at least. And then he was always looking for something to believe in. And he began to dabble in a kind of amateur Kabbalah, the playing with numbers, the playing with musical letters, all these kind of things. It's not important when you're hearing the music, but it was obviously important to him, so to speak, to sign each of his compositions with certain ciphers, symbols, series of notes or pitches or numbers, saying, this is me, and this is the fundament of what is going to follow. But anyway, well, I think we should, first of all, let me just try and start my PowerPoint and show you a couple of nice pictures, and see how we go from there. How are we doing?
Yes, so we can see your screen. So there we are. Perfect.
That seems to be working. So this is just a silhouette and a title page. Now, Let me first introduce Zemlinsky's parents. This is already a huge story in itself, but I'll try and keep it short. Zemlinsky's father originated in what is now the north of Slovakia, near the town of Žilina, a smaller town called Nové Mesto. His family came from Nové Mesto to Vienna. They spelt their name with an S, Zemlinsky, and his father, I believe, sold cigarettes and later became an employee of the then burgeoning railway lines in around Vienna. Zemlinsky Jr., I'll show him now, on the left here, changed his name soon to writing it with a Z, and with the Hungarian SZ, which is pronounced as Zemlinsky, not Zemlinsky. He was born in Vienna in 1845, and the whole family, traced several centuries back, was Catholic. Now, in Vienna, first of all, I would just say that this font, the question of the font, is very interesting. I spoke about this one to Zemlinsky's grandson, not grandson, son-in-law, Arnold Greisler Schoenberg, who's close enough for the family to know a bit, because everybody has always said that the font, Adolf von Zemlinsky's name, is spurious, that he made it up in order to further his name as a writer, which he wanted to be. But on this picture, you see on the sort of altar to his right hand side, there's a regimental hat of some kind, and he's holding a very sparkling looking sword. And Arnold Greisler said to me, they believe that he was awarded some kind of an honor for his role as a soldier in the Austro-Prussian, the Franco-Prussian War. But nobody has ever proved it. Nevertheless, there he is, Adolf von Zemlinsky, with an SZ in the middle, a Christian, a Catholic, in fact, a Catholic. And somehow in the turmoil of the Leopoldstadt, the second precinct of Vienna, he meets Clara Simo. Obviously, she was quite an exotic-looking young lady. That I reckon that photo must have been taken about 1870 or so. So she was not quite the young in the youngest tranche. I think they're kind of wedding photos. In fact, they married in 1870, and their son Alexander was born in 1871. Now, in order to marry, Zemlinsky converted to Judaism. He didn't do it because he's father-in-law told him to, but he did it because he was convinced it was the right thing to do. Now, the father-in-law himself, Shemtov Seymour, was well known. He came from Sarajevo. His family originated actually in Bulgaria. He came from Sarajevo to Vienna and set up a publishing house, published a series of magazines, a monthly or weekly magazines, I forget which, called El Correo de Vienna. They spoke the language that's known as Judeo-Hispanic, Sephardic Spanish, in other words, and they published these the journals in that language, in Hebrew lettering and Spanish-like language. Same was an accredited thinker, a forward-looking, a liberated Jew, and had a lot of influence, not only in Vienna. The magazine was read all over the Sephardic world, down to Greece and Turkey, the Balkans, but he had his setup, he was centered in Vienna. Now, Adolf von Zemlinsky, being a writer, soon began to participate in these productions. He wrote short stories, he wrote novels, which are published serially, when Seymour died, he took over the editorship of the Correo de Vienna. Whether he actually was fluent then in Judeo-Espanol, I do not know. We know very little about him, actually. I apologize for showing these two photographs, which have been published again and again, because they're the only ones we have. But anyway, let me move on. So Zemlinsky wrote a history of the Sephardic community in Vienna. This is what it looks like. He wrote it in German, and it was translated into Judeo-Spanish by an official of the community, Michael Parker. A beautiful book, not very long, but very beautiful. He traced back the history of Sephardi Jews in Vienna as far as they knew, which was about, I think, 1700. So there's that. Alexander was their firstborn, born in 1871, followed a sister, Matilda. They had a couple of misbirths in the war. The younger sister was born 3 years later. She died for 6 weeks. Matilda survived very well, very long time, was born 6 years later. Here's a fascinating picture that I think nobody's ever seen before. As I say, it was sent to me by friends in Vienna. I do not know where they found it, but it shows Zemlinsky at the age of about 14 or 15, together with his sister in a photographic studio. I imagine it was a photograph taken for his bar mitzvah. But it's a very striking portrait of this young, proud young man in his slightly battered looking suit and his have a hat that's far too old for a teenage boy. And then his little sister next to her is also grown, dressed in very, very grown up clothes. Anyway, I think it's a picture to be enjoyed. So when Zemlinsky was a child and his father was secretary of the synagogue, the thing is the Sephardic ritual was always just spoken. They never had any music. But in Vienna, so many of the young Sephardic members of the community went around to the operetta performances, to the opera house, to concerts, to all the entertainments that there were. And it was felt that they should be given music in the synagogue because they would be able to identify with it better, with their faith better if there was music than if it was just plain prose or speech and prayer. So there being no heritage, no tradition of Sephardic music at all in the synagogue, they had to find somebody to make one up for them. And they engaged an Ashkenazi cantor music master from Graz by the name of Jakob Bauer. And with Bauer in charge, I'm sure that Zemlinsky is the son of the secretary of the community, and as a very musical boy, he'd been playing the piano since the age of four and acquired proficiency by the age of six, but he was enrolled to sing in the chorus, in the choir. I have no proof of that, but I do have proof because it's in certain publications, but when after his voice broke, he played the organ in the synagogue. Now, that was only allowed on festival days. The ordinary services were without organ music. They were a cappella choral singing. But they really pulled the stops up. The community lived in peace and prosperity. And in 1888, they inaugurated this new synagogue in the Zirkusgasse. Majestic building. You can see a view from the outside here. And here is a painting. I think cameras were probably not allowed. A painting of the interior. I would have liked to show this in color because the original is in color, but unfortunately the only color copy I could find was covered in some of these logos. So here it is in black and white. You can see there was a cupola with actually stained glass windows, and the light on a sunny day would flood into the synagogue. Must have been a beautiful sight. So that's the synagogue. And that's where Zemlinsky grew up, where he sang probably as a child, where he certainly played the organ, and where he also composed one piece at least has survived. This is Jakob Bauer, by the way, the cantor who ran the music of the Sephardic synagogue. They took old Sephardic folk tunes, mostly from Spain, of course, and put religious sacred words to them. It worked very well. And the chorus was made up. There were 12 boys, and there were six adults, three tenors, three basses, and they were all members of the opera chorus at the Hofoper. So they were professionals. And this was, I think, a very important thing for the young Zemlinsky, that when he started, he was playing the piano, but he also sang, probably, and he certainly played the organ, and he was but he had the influence of professional singers right from the very word go. And it was interesting that He never had any difficulties writing well for the human voice. It was one of his great strengths. So this is Bauer. Now, Bauer had a young daughter, Helene, is his second daughter. His first daughter was the painter of this picture, Manzi Kestel. Bauer's second daughter got married to a young rabbi from Galicia in 1896. And this is the final page of a wedding song that Zemlinsky composed especially for her. It says here, you can't read it very well, it says, "Für Helene Bauer zu ihrer Vermählung komponiert on the 29th of April," it doesn't say, but it's actually 1896, and with a very swashbuckling signature by Zemlinsky underneath it all. It's not a particularly inspiring piece. It was sung as a concert piece at the end of the wedding ceremony, but it has certain themes in it, which he later came back to in Settings of the Psalms. So this was one of his last endeavors for the Sephardic community before he decided in 1898 to withdraw from the community altogether and to become, shall we say, a non-denominative person. Meanwhile, there's so much to tell, but I'll try and keep it as short as I can. He had founded a little chamber orchestra of his own, and the Polyhymnia was called. One of the members of that orchestra was a young band clerk by the name of Arnold Schoenberg, who Zemlinsky said later on scratched away on his cello, but I think they probably were rather better than they made out. I think it was probably a very proficient amateur orchestra. And so he made the friendship of Schoenberg about 1894, 1895. And by this time, Zemlinsky was avidly studying at the conservatory. He had left school at the age of 14 and entered the junior school of the conservatory, studying first of all piano and then later counterpoint, harmony, composition, finally orchestration. And he was perhaps one of the best educated composers of that generation. 6 years of study is quite exceptional, because he went through all the schools from the so-called Vorschule, the preliminary school, to the main study, and then to graduate studies with another composer. I'll show you the teaching staff in a second. But anyway, he made Schoenberg's acquaintance and began to pass on to him everything he had learned about composition. 1890 already, he published this set of piano pieces, his Opus 1, you see. It's kind of entertaining music. It's got certain ambitions to it, but mostly it's light music. And I don't think his teachers were very happy about him publishing this so early in his life. He was only 19 at the time. And I think he regretted it himself later, because it expressed the dichotomy of most of his early career, and actually a good deal of the later career as well, that on the one hand, he had a great genius for entertaining. He was a wonderful conductor of operetta and light music. He was capable of composing it himself, but he always tried not to. And they said, his teachers will have said to him, with this Opus 1 of rustical dances, which are basically waltzes and such, a sort of sequence of waltzes, you have made your name, or you put your name down in musical history as a composer of light music. Is that really what you want to be? And the answer was no. So he held his peace. He didn't publish anything else for about 8 years. And by that time, he was a very seriously minded young man and composed then beautiful songs and so on. So that's the first composition. Now, of course, the entire musical scene in Vienna was dominated by Brahms, which is why I've made his picture bigger than anybody else's on this page. But his first teacher for a short period was Robert Fuchs. Now, Robert Fuchs was rather like Hans Swarovski in the conducting world in the 1950s, 1960s. Everybody who was anybody went to study with him. Fuchs was the teacher of Sibelius, for instance, travel all the way from Helsinki to spend some time in Vienna as a pupil of Fuchs. Leo Fall, the operatic composer, Franz Schreker, the name, the list is endless. I will not try to enumerate them all here. But I should say something about what Fuchs actually taught and what made him so special. Fuchs was a master of what you might call romantic minimalism. He would teach his pupils to take a very, very tiny idea and maybe one rhythm associated with that idea and vary them in every possible way. You could double the note values, you could invert, you could change the order of the, maybe you only had five notes, you could change the order of those notes, you could invert them. It was basically the same kind of approach to composition as Schoenberg later perfected with the 12-note system, except there was no regulation about using all 12 semitones of the octave, but you take a small nucleus and use it to generate, if possible, an entire composition or generate one movement of a composition. This was Robert Fuchs's great strength. He himself didn't seem to have noticed that he had in this method of teaching the seed of fantastic progress, because after all this germinated not only the progression to 12 note music in Europe, but Americans may know of the name Schillinger, Joseph Schillinger, who taught the same kind of techniques in New York and who taught amongst others Gershwin was a great pupil of Schillinger's. And this idea, of course, it also dominates the entire scene of Hollywood or other film composers, because to write a film score, you need to limit your ideas to a small nucleus and build them up. This was Zemlinsky's great gift that he learned from Fuchs. Alma Mahler later said of him, he would take a small melody and knead it in his hands like a piece of clay, and everything possible come out, something sad, something inspiring, something animated, everything. He knew how to just adapt a tiny idea to a huge piece. Hugo Wolf was very critical of this technique, although he himself studied with Robert Fuchs, and he described it, as he described the music of Brahms, as the art of composing without ideas, which I think is, there's a nucleus of truth to that, but the idea had to be there, even if it was very small. So that was Robert Fuchs. Then in 1890, Zemlinsky moved on to J.N. Fuchs, Johann Nepomuk Fuchs. I haven't written it out in full because there isn't room. Johann Nepomuk Fuchs, who was a more practically minded man. He was a theatre conductor. He was an orchestrator. He was the editor of certain volumes of the Schubert Complete Edition, and altogether a more worldly man. He also conducted at the court opera in Vienna, though he very rapidly fell foul of Mahler when he arrived in 1897. That was Fuchs. At the end of the line, Hanslick, of course, who was not a teacher, but wielded his pen furiously and very professionally above everything that happened in the musical world in Vienna and anything that came to Vienna. And then just to throw in a friend and colleague, Richard Heuberger, there was a huge clique, but this is one guy that's interesting because Zemlinsky helped him write his most successful operetta, the opera ball, and to actually compose the overture for it. But I'll come to that later. So there's a little rogues gallery of people who were around Zemlinsky when he was making his name as a musician, as a young musician in Vienna.
And did he also study with Bruckner, or is that inaccurate that one sees sometimes that reference that he studied with Bruckner as well?
As far as I know, he attended some of Bruckner's lectures. Bruckner was at the university, you see, and Zemlinsky was at the conservatory. But I think as a guest, he was allowed to attend lectures at the university. He had no particular relationship to Bruckner at all. He scarcely conducted any of Bruckner's music in his late years at all. Where he's a great Mahlerian, it's strange that one of the things that always fascinated me about Zemlinsky in Vienna, Busoni in Berlin, Bruckner in St. Florian in Vienna, so these people lived simultaneously and didn't necessarily ever make any contact. It's such a rich period in musical and cultural history in Europe that one can follow all these traces and they don't necessarily ever cross. Now, he did cross the path of Mahler. This is interesting. Zemlinsky wrote his first opera in 1895, and completed it in 1895, Sarema, not a marvelous piece, very Wagnerian, but he entered it for a competition in Munich and won one of the prizes. They didn't consider any of the operas good enough to get the first prize, so awarded three equal prizes. And the wonderful thing, of course, was that each of these operas was then given a performance or a short series of performances at the state opera or the court opera in Munich. And Zemlinsky had the good luck that his Sarema, it's a story based on the Caucasus. It's a kind of all about Islamic terrorists, actually, but playing in the 1850s. The title role, Sarema, was taken by one of the great Bayreuth sopranos who happened to be on the music staff of the court opera in Munich. And she must have taken a liking to this piece, made it a fantastic success. So the word spread back to Vienna that Zemlinsky's Sarema was wonderful. And the rumor had it that Mahler wanted to conduct this piece at the court opera in Vienna. This wasn't actually true. It was these words that were put into his mouth by certain musical journalists and coffee house friends. But then Zemlinsky wrote the second opera, Es war einmal, and I would always fondly imagine, this is a story that has been told, that Mahler looked at the score of Sarema and summoned Zemlinsky and said, oh, I would like to conduct this piece. And Zemlinsky said, but Meister, I'm working on a new opera, do that instead. And that was the agreement. This is absolutely untrue. It's extraordinary how this sort of little legend has perpetuated itself. He didn't know Mahler from Adam. He wrote the opera all on his own. And when he'd finished, can you imagine, he just left the score with a short letter to Mahler at the porter's office, the stage door. And somehow it was taken through to Mahler's office. He saw the score, he liked it. He summoned Zemlinsky then to him, who played it through. Mahler criticized him, told him what needed to be changed. And so he put all his energy and strength into, although he didn't actually like the music very much, he said to his friends, it's rather derivative, isn't it? You're always struggling to find out who actually wrote it. But he conducted it all the same, and he had some of his finest singers. He did the stage direction himself, and it came out, as you can see here from this playbill, on the 22nd of January 1900. This is the extraordinary thing, this was the climax of Zemlinsky's career as a composer. He was only 29. He had this performance at the court opera. The piece was performed altogether 12 times, which for a so-called novelty in those days was quite substantial. Most novelties were given three or four times at the most. If you happened to be called Richard Strauss or Hans Pfitzner, you got more performances than that. But as I say, most things were for the sake of keeping the operatic flame burning. They would encourage young composers to put in scores, they would perform them, and then they would fall by the wayside. And nowadays, if you go through the archives, you find some of them still lying there, forgotten and covered in dust. But anyway, Es war einmal did very well. And a few days later, Zemlinsky conducted a big concert at the Musikverein, the big Golden Hall in Vienna, a cantata for two soloists and a big orchestra and chorus in memory of Brahms. And a few days after that, there was another world premiere of a short piece he'd written for trio voices and piano called Friedel, a little spiel opera, a little comic opera, which he himself written the text. And these things in quick succession, more or less made his name at the age of 29. And from then on, this is the story of his life. This was always aroused my fascination, enthusiasm, and compassion is that from then on, his life was just on the way down. One thing went wrong after another. He did have his triumphs in between, but most of his life was a distinct crescendo from this very evening on the 22nd of January 1900. So here, what happened? In the summer of 1900, Adolf von Zemlinsky died suddenly at the age of 55 from a very nasty, when he was affected by kidney stones, and died because they couldn't be operated. So in the summer of 55, his father died, and Zemlinsky was left having to provide for his mother and his sister. And as he turned out in the earlier years, he'd made a very good career, he was a very great aptitude as a conductor. He'd never really studied conducting, but he turned out to be a natural talent. And in the late summer of 1900, he signed on at this theatre, the Carl Theatre, which was not far from where he lived, as a conductor of operetta. He hated it. He hated every minute of it. But he held it out in this theatre for 3 years. It wasn't even particularly well paid, but it was better than scraping by on occasional piano or composition lessons. Now this is what happened. His sister became engaged to Schoenberg. This is Matilda Zemlinsky with Schoenberg, and their mother, or Schoenberg's mother, future mother-in-law, Clara, on holiday south of Vienna in the very lovely mountainous region called Payerbach in the summer of 1901. Now, because Schoenberg had to earn a living and needed a permanent job, and there was a child on the way, they were reliant on help from outside. And what happened? He had luck. There was a big movement which had started out in 1901, called the Überbrettel. I'm sure many of you have heard of that. The Überbrettel, it's a joke, because a brettel is a vulgar German word for a stage, the wooden boards of a stage. And the Über, of course, is a reference back to Nietzsche and the Übermensch, the Superman. So it's a super slummock, you might say, Überbrettel. The idea was that in the new century, good art, serious art, should somehow appeal to and be accepted by everybody from whichever walk of life they came from. Well, it didn't work out. Those who went to the Überbrettel Theater, wherever it set up its stage, were mostly good middle-class cultivated people, and the idea of reaching out to other strata of the society didn't really work. For a short time, this was the rage. It died out almost as quickly as it had started. But Zemlinsky happened to have written this piece, Juli Hexen. It's quite a long poem by Otto Julius Bierbaum, who was one of the leading literary contributors to the Überbrettel movement. And it was performed at the opening night of the new theatre, the Buntes Theater, the brightly colored theatre, as you could say in English, in Berlin. Now, the fascinating thing about this photograph is there are five dancers on stage. We have a photograph of the world premiere, but the music is lost. So there you have just a picture, and that's all that's left of that movement. Now, what happens is the Überbrettel Theatre came down made a little European tour. They started in Vienna in the summer of 1901, then they moved on to Prague, and then from Dresden and back to Berlin. And in Vienna, Zemlinsky and brought Schoenberg along, and he met the organizers of the Überbrettel in Berlin, and they offered him a job as a composer and Kapellmeister, and clutching at the straw, as it were, because I said he urgently needed to earn a living. They took him along to Berlin, and he may have been involved in this performance, we don't know. But anyway, he spent some time in Berlin. After the theatre closed for lack of funds, he had to find his a way in Berlin teaching counterpoint and so on. Zemlinsky, meanwhile, back in Vienna, was avidly conducting at the Karl Theater. And as I said earlier, just one day after his premiere of the Friedel in February 1900, he met Alma Mahler, Alma Schindler, I beg your pardon, Alma Schindler. She became Alma Mahler some years later at a party. It was a party given for a Belgian symbolist painter called Fernand Knopf. They met by chance. But by the autumn, she'd fallen for him, and she also determined that she wanted him to teach her composition. So in late August 1900, he came along and started giving her composition lessons. And this soon became, shall we say, rather closer than the teacher-pupil relationship. She became completely infatuated with him. He went head over heels with her. In fact, he had a wonderful fiancée, Melanie Gutmann, who got sort of pushed out of the way. And they had a stormy affair, which lasted well into the following, the September, October, November of 1901. Now, her birthday, I think it was her 21st birthday, I may be wrong, was 31st of August. And this is an entry from her diary. She'd gone to this morning to the post office, received a letter. The letter is a letter from Zemlinsky and a delightful Überbrettl song. And says, I'm putting it in here. What she did was she would cut little slits in the pages of her diary. And if it was a letter or a postcard, she would slit it in so it was there forever. This was a larger piece, was a piece of manuscript paper, so she probably just laid it in. And when my dear colleague Susanna Rhoda Braman and I started working on transcribing these diaries for publication, we looked everywhere for this song but couldn't find it. It has gone. Several years later, I received post from the archivist of the Mahler collection. It's at the University of Philadelphia, Penn State University in Philadelphia, special collections. Was all put there because of Alma's much later friendship with Eugene Ormaney, incidentally. One day the postman came with a little parcel, and inside was just a few fragments of paper. What had happened was, in the archive, they had found this sealed brown envelope, and it had been sealed ever since Alma had deposited them there in the early 1960s, I believe. And finally, they became so inquisitive about it, said, we must open this envelope and see what's inside. So they did, and there was this song by Zemlinsky, but torn into 8 irregular fragments. I can almost imagine what happened, that Alma met Mahler at a party in November 1901, and he began to woo her very, shall we say, energetically. And successfully. By December, they had agreed to get married, and the following spring, they did in fact get married. I can just imagine the situation of Alma waiting for Mahler to come to lunch, has Zemlinsky's song laid out on the piano, and I'll show it to you in a minute. We'll hear a few bars of it in a minute. It's a very risque number. It's about the Lorelei, who's in this case Resi with blonde hair, is combing her locks. And on the other side of the Rhine is a young student expecting her for an assignation that evening. A polite word for what an assignation. Heute Nacht, this evening. And Zemlinsky had already composed this once in a slightly sort of a march-like style. This is a much more subtle one, written for Alma's eyes only, and this is as yet still unpublished, but there is one commercial recording of which I'd like to play you just a few bars.
In der Sonnengasse zu St. Gohan, da kämmt sich die Resi ihr schwarzes Haar, sie lacht in den Spiegel verstohlenen Blicks, über ihrem Bette hängt ein Kruzifix. Töpfchen
It's nothing very special, let's be frank, but Hugo Wolf could have written something of the kind, but it was written specially for her, and she was very proud of it, and then she was very ashamed of it, and then she was ashamed of being ashamed of it, of having torn it up and put it away in this envelope, and it was found decades later. Quite interesting. So Zemlinsky stuck it out at the Carl Theater for 3 years. Meanwhile, he'd lost Alma to Gustav Mahler, and he'd started thinking about making a career as a serious composer. So 3 years at the Carl Theater, he moved on to another operetta theater, the Theater in der Wien, a very historical building. This is, I believe, where Fidelio was first performed. But in those days, it was in the middle of, more, it looks as if you're in the middle of nowhere. But nowadays, there's the bustling victuals market, the food market running down the street in front of it, so it looks completely different. But this is a photograph actually taken, I believe, around 1900. So, but it was a slightly better theatre, but he still had to spend all his time conducting operetta. Meanwhile, he'd met a wonderful writer, Leo Feld, who was suffering the same problem. He was writing comedies and sketches and so on, and had a calling for the higher. He wanted to write really serious things. They got together, they signed a little contract and started working on an opera called Der Traumgürger, George the Dreamer. They started in 1903 and it was completed by 1906. 1904, Zemlinsky finally made the grade from being a conductor of operetta to a conductor of opera. This was a theater that had been built for a jubilee of Kaiser Franz Josef and was standing empty until an entrepreneur called Rainer Simons rented it and founded what was called the Volksoper, which opened in September 1904. And from the outset, he engaged Zemlinsky as chief conductor, and there he was conducting Weber and Mozart and even Wagner, and had lasted, achieved his ambition of being a serious conductor. And though he still remained a genius, actually, in conducting operetta, but he tried to avoid it when he could, and offers to compose an operetta, he rejected categorically. So this is the Volksoper. Then, when he completed the Traumgürger, it was intended for Mahler to conduct it at the court opera, and in fact, it had been announced to the press as such. But meanwhile, Mahler was having troubles with the powers that be at the court opera, because he wanted to spend much more time away from Vienna, conducting at the Met or with the New York Philharmonic in America, and also performing his symphonies in other places. And finally, they agreed. It was agreed between him and the powers that be at the court of Franz Josef that he would cancel his contract. Now, the cancellation of the contract happened just a few days before rehearsals began for Zemlinsky's Traumgürger. He'd already had a series of disasters, of pieces not being completed or being turned down since 1900, but this was the last straw. Mahler left. He was succeeded by Felix Weingartner, who didn't like Zemlinsky at all, simply refused point blank to honor the contract that had been made for the Traumgürger, and it never got performed at all. So I'm going to stop the PowerPoint at this moment, I said, and just, I beg your pardon. No, I will stop here. There we go. There you are. There, Kirill. Is this a good time to maybe interrupt and offer the round for questions or remarks?
Well, everybody is in participation is welcome to ask questions. I am just engrossed in listening to you, and I think you will talk about it. I'm very interested about the continuation of his downward trajectory and his exile in America and so on and so forth. But wherever you want to take it, because I find it utterly fascinating and a very valuable run through Zemlinsky's background.
Okay, I haven't even talked really about the character of his music very much. We've talked about some of the building bricks that he learns as a child, but I will leave that for later. What I'd like to do is give a sort of rundown of what you call in a slightly jovial way, Zemlinsky's greatest hits, because once he got to the Volksoper as chief conductor, he really did settle down to the serious business of writing really good music. The Traumgeuge was actually, the Traumgeuge, although it never got performed during his lifetime, was basically the piece with which he identified most closely. It's a piece, well, I must admit, even now, I was present at the world premiere, which was in Nuremberg in 1980, and I remember then sitting in the audience with goosebumps at certain places. It's music that really gets under the skin, and it still does that to me and other people who hear it. It's the story of a young boy who sets out to conquer the world to get the most beautiful princess for his wife, and has to end up compromising with reality and realizing that he's failed, going back to the village in which he was born and leading an ordinary, shall we say, sensible life as one of many. And I'm afraid that's why Zemlinsky identified it with it so closely. And this is why we're talking about his search for good fortune, that search was always fruitless to the very end, that the harder he tried, the harder it seemed to become to fulfill any of the hopes he had placed in himself and his undeniable talent, the search for good fortune. Tom Gerge tells that story in the most heartbreaking way. I don't know if any of our listeners know the novel Jude the Obscure by Thomas Hardy, which is an even more tragic sort of the same kind of story of a boy from the countryside with intellectual propensities, whose one ambition in life is to get to Oxford and study and become a celebrated scholar. And he achieves it. He gets to Oxford with his three children and his wife, but they have no money. And he goes out to look for some food. When he comes back, he discovers that the eldest of the children has hanged the others and then hanged himself. Tom Gerger isn't quite that tragic, but it has the same bitter tang about it. Wonderful music, incredibly complex music. So that was the piece from which he set out. He followed it with a comedy based on Gottfried Keller, Kleider machen Leute, clothes make the man, also a very big, ambitious piece. That was actually performed in Vienna. He conducted it himself at the Volksoper, but his time there was running out. There were problems with the orchestra at the Volksoper. The director of the theatre wanted to disband them, and his contract, which was due to expire in April or May of 1911, was not renewed. But then fortunately he got an offer from Prague. They had just had a disaster. Their longtime intendant, Angela Neumann, who had actually employed Mahler as his chief conductor years before, had died. And his last few years, he'd become rather tetchy and not allowed anybody to occupy the position of chief conductor. But except that the standards had gone down, and they urgently needed a good musical director. So Zemlinsky packed his bags, much attached as he was to his beloved Vienna, and moved up the road to Prague. And there he stayed for 16 years and had some remarkable successes as a conductor. I'd like to talk about those first. It was all for ensemble theatres. They did have guest singers, but it was nothing like the major guest business of nowadays, where people are flying around all over the world, singing a performance and coming back again and so on. Well, they had a stock ensemble of singers who were there all the time on permanent contract. So you could achieve certain results. They maybe weren't the most wonderful singers, but they were the most usable singers. And Zemlinsky established in Prague a fantastic reputation as a conductor of Mozart. The Pontes, all the standard Mozart. He didn't go off the beaten track to the earlier Mozart, but he conducted the big six pieces. And it's often quoted a line of Igor Stravinsky, who happened to be in Prague once for a meeting with Diaghilev, and he had the evening off or whatever, he went to the theatre and heard the performance of the Marriage of Figaro conducted by Zemlinsky. This must have been about 1912, I think. And he said in his memoirs, one of his conversations with Volokhov, it was the most perfect performance of an opera I have ever heard. That is often quoted, but what is not quoted, and I find quite as revealing, is from the memoirs of the conductor Joseph Cripps. Now, I, as a youngster in London, had the privilege sort of playing under the direction of Joseph Cripps. Actually, he was a crotchety old man, but he was a remarkable conductor. Joseph Cripps, in his first season, was appointed musical director in a small town. It's on the German-Czech borders. Today it's called Ustin ad Labem. In those days it was called Aussich an der Elbe. It's just an hour and a half on the train from Prague to Aussich, and Cripps was chief conductor there. And in his memoirs he writes, whenever I had time, I would take the train to Prague and watch Zemlinsky conduct at his opera. And he said, I just adored his way with Mozart, the simplicity, the purity of it, quite the opposite of Bruno Walter. And Cripps often counted in our time as one of the leading Mozart interpreters. One thinks of his series of symphonic recordings with the Concertgebouw, or his wonderful ensemble performances in Vienna of the Pontes and so on. Cripps said, everything, well, he didn't, I won't exaggerate, he said, Zemlinsky was a huge influence on my own interpretation of Mozart. So here's a tradition that goes from the beginning of the century to our time, unforcedly, people adapting to situations in global. I think that's perhaps more revealing to me than the famous quotation of Stravinsky. So while he was in Prague, Zemlinsky composed a series of striking works. First of all, a new opera, a couple of operas based on stories by Oscar Wilde, a Florentine tragedy, and The Dwarf, as it's called, The Dwarf, Der Zwerg, are based on Oscar Wilde's The Birthday of the Infanta. But he also composed, I'm afraid this is going to come rather short, this evening, he composed a masterful string quartet. This was his second string quartet, composed in 1915 and dedicated actually to Schoenberg. They'd had a terrible row. They'd been such good friends for such a long time. They fell out. They had a row. And then this quartet was composed in a big way to make amends. It's a one movement work which runs for nearly 40 minutes, extremely difficult to play, one of his great masterpieces. I would recommend that to anybody who's looking at Zemlinsky, perhaps from a beginner's, look for the second string quartet, look for the two Oscar Wilde operas. And then by this time we got past the First World War, he composed perhaps his other great orchestral masterpiece, the Lyric Symphony, which is for soprano and baritone and large orchestra. I haven't even mentioned his first orchestral masterpiece, absolutely unforgivable, 1903, as a reaction to his loss of Alma. He composed the symphonic poem The Mermaid, based on the fairy tale by Hans Christian Andersen, The Mermaid. I should have mentioned it because today it is his most frequently performed piece, statistically. It's also perhaps the easiest to enjoy. I will be talking about it later, if time allows, The Mermaid. But then came the Lyric Symphony, which was, we could say, the non plus ultra, his furthest point in the style he'd been cultivating since the turn of the century of post-romanticism, whatever you might call it, late romanticism. This was the climax of it. And suddenly he was confronted with the situation. He said, I can't go on any longer. It's 1924. Kurt Weill is already making an appearance. Schreker, everything is moving forwards. Hindemith is beginning to emerge. Krennic, the younger generation, said, if I go on composing late romantic music, they will walk all over me. It will not be not lead any words forwards. Now, 1 year later, his sister Matilda died, and in her memory, he composed a third string quartet, which is a complete break with post-romanticism. It's a, shall we say, an edgy staccato-like piece, but it has wonderful depths to it. The third movement, a romanza, is dedicated to, particularly dedicated to Matilda's memory, although her name features nowhere on the actual printed score. We know it was written in memory of her. And then followed many years of silence. While it wasn't really silence, he continued to compose, but he didn't finish anything. He started on a new quartet, he started on a big opera. Nothing could sort of fulfill his own ambitions of what he was to be, of a traditionally schooled composer in a rapidly modernizing world, until he had another tragedy in the family. His own wife, Ida, died of cancer in 1929. In Berlin. By then he'd moved to Berlin. I won't show the slides. He moved to Berlin as second conductor to Klemperer at the Krolloper, which for him was a major breakthrough, because in Berlin he really earned a better salary. In Prague they'd been relying entirely on private subsidies for their the survival of the theatre. There's much to tell. In Prague, when Zemlinsky came to Prague, the German community was already in the minority. At the turn of the century, there were more Germans in Prague than Czechs in the city, I believe. At any rate, it changed. As the one community grew, the other community vanished. And after the First World War, the German community was very much taken on itself. And when I say German community, almost all the so-called Germans in Prague were in fact German Jews or Austrian Jews. It was not a German community as such, it was a Jewish community. Anyway, Zemlinsky moved to Berlin, and he then composed, in memory of his wife Ida, the third song of the set of symphonic songs with which you introduced me kindly this evening. And then he went on to write seven more. They're all based on Afro-American poetry, four of them by Langston Hughes, the famous Langston Hughes, all translated into German. Incidentally, Zemlinsky composed a large number of Lieder, but he didn't rely so much on German classics or moderns. At least half of his songs are settings of poetry in other languages. He himself was a miserable linguist. His second wife, Louise, said to me, 16 years in Prague, he didn't learn enough Czech even to order a tram ticket. He loved to read poetry from other lands, other countries, in German translation. Unfortunately, there was quite a lot. He'd done poetry from the Sanskrit, poetry from the Chinese, from the Russian, from the Turkish, many, many different corners, ambitions. But then suddenly this book came on the market in Germany about 1920, called Afrika Singt, with a selection of quite well-translated Afro-American poetry from the Harlem Renaissance. And a rather strange combination of cultures, as it may seem. Here's this Jewish non-believer working and composing in Berlin, conducting, bonding with culture from a completely different end of the planet, from completely different people he would never met in real life. Well, he did later in America, but it's fascinating, I find, how he reached out to make that connection simply on the merits of the wonderful literature he found in front of him. So that was the symphonic songs, and they moved into the next piece, was his last opera one, the Chalk Circle, based on the old legend of King Solomon and the two mothers of one child, you know, struggling for one child, and they're put into a circle and told to pull the child if the strongest mother will pull the child out of the circle, and the actual mother refuses because she says, if I do that, I will kill the child. But it's the old legend turned by Klabund into a Chinese story. It had been very popular as a play. Zemlinsky himself had seen it in Prague with incidental music by Victor Ullmann, who was one of his assistants. Victor Ullmann, who later acquired a tragic celebrity as having composed music in the ghetto of Theresienstadt. Victor Ullmann wrote music for this Zeitgeist, the chalk circle. Zemlinsky then decided to compose a complete opera on it, which he dedicated to his second wife, Louise, as a wedding present. So that takes us well into the 1930s. 1932 was the first he completed it. 1933 it was to be performed in Berlin. But we all know what happened in 1933. Zemlinsky had already had troubles because he was often conducting in Prague. There was a scandal concert when he was booked to conduct Beethoven's choral symphony for a German choral society who were paying allegiance to President Masaryk on his birthday. So they hired four soloists and Zemlinsky and this German chorus. But there were big problems. The Prague public did not want to hear Schiller sung in German, whereas the choral society was made entirely of Germans. They could only contemplate singing Schiller in German. There was a huge row, and in the end it was decided that the soloists would sing mostly in German, though the tenor, who was a Slovenian, said, "I'll sing in French." The soloists were going to sing in Czech, and the Slovenian tenor was going to sing in French, and the chorus was going to sing in German. That's how it started out. And at the dress rehearsal, the baritone stood up at the beginning of the last, well, when he continued to come in, the last movement, and started singing in German. Hushed whispers from Zemlinsky, no, you've got to sing in Czech. So he started singing in Czech. And then somebody from the chorus stood up and said, "We can't follow the entry." And there was a scandal, but the performance did take place. But when Zemlinsky got back to Berlin a few days later, he was fired. So his last season he was then reinstated again, but he was fired. His last season was devoted above all to conducting a fantastically successful chamber portion of Weill's Mahagoni, the opera Mahagoni, but in a version for small orchestra in a small theatre on the Kurfürstendamm. It was fascinating again to see this doyen of classical Viennese tradition of composing, bonding with Kurt Weill and Brecht. There's a wonderful photograph of them at a piano together, and a wonderful eyewitness account of the dress rehearsal in this theatre, written by the East German composer Wolfgang Wagner Regeni in his memoirs. He was present, and he remembers how suddenly, in the midst of it all, Zemlinsky put his baton down and stopped and said to Weill, "You've got to compose some extra music there. We need a transition." So everybody went and took a break, and Weill rushed into the auditorium with ordinary sheets of paper and started composing, I don't know how many bars it was. The music, unfortunately, the music from that production has been lost. But it was fascinating how they respected him. So he had to leave Berlin, 1933. He first of all settled back in Vienna. For quite a while, Hermann Scherchen was conducting an orchestra of people who had lost their jobs from other orchestras with some success, but he got a big offer from Switzerland and decided that was more to his advantage. Zemlinsky took over that orchestra and by then was conducting a lot of contemporary music, Hindemith and Koenig and his own things as well, of course. And so it went on. Then 1935, Louise, his second wife, came from the library with a German translation of a play by André Gide called Le Roi Candaule, King Candaules. And he looked at it and said, "I've got to set this to music." So he started and he sketched away. And then in the middle of it all, one of his dearest friends, I haven't even mentioned him, but I have to now, Alban Berg, died of a sudden poisoning, of a blood poisoning, Christmas 1935. And Zemlinsky abandoned Korngold for a while and sat down and wrote a new string quartet in Berg's memory. Then he resumed Korngold, and by that time, and he started orchestrating it. And by that time, the situation in Austria had become almost intolerable, as is well known. In March 1938, the Nazis marched in and annexed the country. Zemlinsky's initial reaction to this new development in his life was not exactly praiseworthy. Now, his wife, Louise, was 100% Jewish. She came from a family of Prague Jews. And she said, I have to go. I will book my passage to America tomorrow. Will you come with me? And he said, let me think about it. And he spent the next few days going from one office to a government office to another, looking for his papers to prove that he was of Aryan descent. He got his father's birth certificate from the Catholic Church. He got his father's, his mother's birth certificate, not his mother's, sorry, his grandmother's birth certificate. He collected a whole pile of family papers, all from the Catholic Church. But then he also had to submit his parents' wedding certificate, marriage certificate. And that was in the archives of the Jewish Cultural Center in Vienna, which had long since, we're talking about the summer of 1938, the first thing that the Gestapo did when he came to Vienna was to confiscate the archive, because that way they could trace everybody who was Jewish within the entire community. So it was impossible to find a copy of the marriage certificate. And then he came very crestfallen to Louise and said, okay, I'm coming with you. So he booked a passage. They first of all emigrated for a few months to the Czech Republic, or to Czechoslovakia, as it's known, to Prague, stayed in Prague, and moved on. Finally, they flew to Rotterdam, took a boat from there, and settled in New York. The idea was they'd been summoned there by one of Zemlinsky's oldest friends, Arto Bodansky, who since 1915 had been chief conductor of German operatic repertoire at the Met. Bodansky said, come to New York, I will conduct your new opera at the Met. It was a great offer, and obviously Bodansky had conducted a lot of Zemlinsky's music, including in America, where he was totally unknown. Came to America, they sat down around New Year 1939 with the manuscript, with the libretto, and as it transpires, in the second act of Le Roi Condole, König Korngold, the soprano is expected to strip naked. Now, Bodansky had had enough difficulty over the years performing Salome, or the Rosenkavalier, the scene of the opening scene of Rosenkavalier, with the two women lying on a bed together. One of the wives of the sponsors of the Met stood up in indignation, said, this will never do, and left the theatre, and the performance of Rosenkavalier never took place. Actually, it took place. Bodansky only got to conduct Rosenkavalier at the Met in 1933, can you imagine? So his idea of, they were talking out in 1939, 1940, now, the idea of conducting an opera by a totally unknown Austrian composer with nudity on the stage was out of the question. So Zemlinsky had no choice but to put the piece aside, and happened to meet on the street an old friend of his from Berlin, a playwright and photographer who'd issued a wonderful book of photographs called Wir an der Oper, photographs of artists from the State Opera in Berlin. And he and his wife were also in America as exiles, and they got their heads together and started on a last opera, Circe, which Zemlinsky never finished. He composed a short score of an act and a half, and Then he had a violent stroke and never composed again, the completely debilitating stroke. He lived on for another year or so, and then he died in complete obscurity in Westchester County. They managed to build themselves a house in Westchester County. He lived in that house for just 4 days before he died. In Europe, nobody, of course, took any notice, and nothing happened really again until, well, the recording we heard at the beginning of this seminar of 1964, the Baltimore, the conductor was a pupil of his in Prague, he was one of the first to do something for Zemlinsky in a completely uninterested world. Things began to look up. Well, I remember this as a child. Mahler was born in 1860. Yeah? So there was an anniversary in 1960. Then he died in 1911. So there was another anniversary in 1961, the 50th anniversary of his death. And all the powers that be in the BBC, who all happened to be, almost all in those days, happened to be refugees from Germany and Austria, Hans Keller, Moscow Kahn, I don't have to name them all, put their heads together and said the BBC will promote over two seasons the complete orchestral works of Mahler. Meanwhile, the same thing was happening with Leonard Bernstein and the New York Philharmonic. So, and Mahler suddenly came back. Mahler, who I remember as a child, they said, oh, it's all long, it's loud, it goes on far beyond its time. It's horrible music, in a word. And suddenly everybody became enthralled by Mahler. And it was like a breaking down of a barrier, that the past that everybody had, since the war, had carefully filtered out what had happened before the war. They preferred not to know. Music was moving forward since the war had finished. Boulez and Stockhausen, I don't need to tell you, all the people know that, but Korngold had the misfortune, to have survived the war. And he returned to Vienna in 1955, expecting to be greeted in triumph, and they just didn't want to know. He went back to America, very, very disappointed, and spent the rest of his days in California. Zemlinsky died, shall we say, in 1942, in the middle of it all, in total obscurity. Franz Schreker had died, fortunately for him, shall we say, sounds a bit cruel to say, he died fortunately just before the outbreak of Nazism in 1933, so he never had to experience that. Really, in any full way, the horrors of what they all others went through with exile and flight and loss of family, all those things. So that brings us to the end of Zemlinsky's life, and maybe it's now a good moment to open the forum for any question, or if you, Kirill, has anything you'd like to ask, give me a couple of moments to drink a glass of water.
Yes, of course. Well, thank you for this overview of Zemlinsky's life. And of course, it seems to symbolize or be symbolic of the of this incredible cataclysm, the catastrophe of the Second World War. And of course, we could name Bela Bartok and Arnold Schoenberg and Thomas Mann and any number of these shards of European culture, Rachmaninoff more Slavic, but shards of Europe and European culture that ended up in America and in many ways cross-pollinated it. It's interesting you mentioned Joseph Schillinger before, because one of his students was Lee Burke, who founded the Berklee at the time School of Music, which was called the Schillinger House in Boston, which has now become the world's biggest school for jazz and popular music. So all these interconnections abound, but I think the next section of what you're going to talk about is very much about interconnections and connections and the numerology that so attracted Zemlinsky in the unfortunate search for fortune. So it would be interesting to see that, hear more music, and of course questions. And I think we do have a question from Victor Nicoara, who says, thank you for a captivating talk, Antony. A couple of rather prosaic questions. What would you say Zemlinsky's character was like, and is he known to have kept pets? I think this is the first time we have a question that involves pets. You have a dog that you're very fond of. So thank you, Victor, for your question. And tell us, Antony.
Yes, greetings, Victor. What has always appealed to me about Zemlinsky, are you hearing me?
Yes, yes.
Yes, good. What has always appealed to me about Zemlinsky is his personality. He was modest, he was witty, he could be a difficult person as well. Who couldn't in the arts world? My dog, incidentally, has just come to say hello as well. I don't think I'll lift him up. He wants to go for his walk, but he'll just have to wait. Okay. Yes, Zemlinsky always kept a dog. Like many other artists, Busoni was a great dog lover. Busoni liked big dogs.
San Bernard's, no? Giotto.
Giotto, the San Bernardo, also had a Newfoundlander when he was younger, and was huge, almost as large as a small pony. Was Zemlinsky tended, because he rarely lived in, shall we say, larger apartments or so. He always had a small dog, but he loved his dogs, and there's stories of them going out on the Austria lakes and boating, and the dog permanently jumping out of the boat and having to be rescued, and so on. And later, in 1933, before when they left Berlin, they first of all took up an apartment in Switzerland. It was a house in which Hermann Hesse had lived and written his great novel, The Glass Bead Game. The Villa Carmagnola, I think it was called. There's a lovely story of how Louise is trying to get the dinner and the dog is permanently getting under her feet and so on. So there was much love. And even at the end of his life, there's a very tragic last photograph of him sitting crippled in a wheelchair in the garden of their house in New York State. And you can just see that the end of his hand is stroking the head of a dog. So they managed that even then. Yes, it was a delightful person, I'm sure. And he had this wonderful Viennese humor. He always found the mot juste for the strangest of things. There's one of his jokes I particularly, well, it's not even a joke, it's just a remark that I'm particularly fond of, that he wrote his setting of Psalm 23 in 1910, which I want to play, if time allows, I want to play you some of that later, a little bit. Years afterwards, it still hadn't been printed by his publishers. So he wrote to the publisher complaining, and he got a letter back saying, we're having difficulties getting it printed. And Zemlinsky writes, I know that my psalm is difficult to sing, but I didn't know it was difficult to print. And there's a sort of subtle Viennese sort of twang of fatalistic humor underneath that is just typical of him. I'm sure we miss many such things because his letters are full of slang and so on, but they're not necessarily full of jokes. Just as, by the way, the letters of Klemperer, which are edited, Klemperer was famous for his jokes, but his letters are extraordinarily serious, with very few traces of humor in them. I think artist personalities don't necessarily always come out as you expect in print or in the written form. But okay, a long answer to a short question. Sorry.
Thank you. So do tell us more about Zemlinsky and now the music and what you see as the numerological implications, please.
Yeah. So this is going into the arcane side of his music making. Now, when he started messing about, shall we say, with numbers and letters and so on, he hadn't quite found a sense of direction. And so his first experiments are with cryptograms. We all know about BSCH, Shostakovich is DSCH. You take the musical letters in somebody's name and make them into a theme or a melody, and you can do all sorts of things. We know that maybe Ronald Stevenson's great fantasy on DSCH, Passacaglia, big one on DSCH. Many composers have done that. Berg was another notable case, taking these letters and turning them into musical themes. So this was Zemlinsky's first attempt. In his case, it was a sort of sense of humor. In 1898, there was a competition. It was actually an annual competition, the Beethoven Prize of Vienna, which was very, shall we say, there was great kudos attached to winning this prize. And Zemlinsky decided to submit a work for it in the 1898. Now, as was normal then, and probably is now as well, with composition competitions, is that you have to submit a score without your name on it. Instead, you choose a motto, some collection of words or letters, and put them on the score, and then you submit an envelope with the motto on the outside, and then inside you write down your name and address so that they know who you are and where to send the score when you haven't won a prize. So that was the condition, those were the conditions then as well. And I think Zemlinsky was very amused by the idea of not being allowed to put his name on the manuscript, because all the adjudicators knew him and his handwriting perfectly well, and even without a signature, they would have been able to identify him. Nevertheless, this is what he did. He was in those days engaged to Melanie Gutmann, whose younger sister he later married. And they were on holiday in Payerbach, a place they loved to visit, in the summer of 1897. And Zemlinsky had to go back to Vienna to attend to business, leaving Melanie with Arnold Schoenberg on holiday. And he composed a song to bid her farewell. Der Tag wird kühl, day goes cold, here comes the music. I'll stop it there, if I can. Yes, I'll stop it there. Now, you will have noticed, I'm sure, that the main theme is the three notes at the beginning, F sharp. I think I'll go back to the picture without having the music. F sharp, C sharp, B, B natural. F sharp, C sharp, B natural. Comes again and again and again through the song. So later on, he comes to write his symphony. That's what he went back to Vienna for. And because of this question of not putting his name on the manuscript, he turns his first name into letters. You can see here, A-E-A-D-E. And Melanie's happen to coincide, the E-A-E of Melanie. So he puts both names, actually. And using the techniques he had learned from Robert Fuchs, he readjusts the sequence of pitches from A-E-A-E. A D A E to A D A E D, what was known as an interversion, just a change of sequence. And so you already see that the theme of Der Tag wird kühl, the E is here, A E D in the interversion, transposed a third higher. And then he transposed it again into B flat because he wants to write a symphony in B flat. And so he's in fact signing his name at the beginning of the symphony with his own and his Melanie's name, kind of hidden. I'll just play you the opening of the symphony. You can see what I mean, I think. You see the theme? Now, that may look as if it's a coincidence, but to make perfectly clear that he really did mean to quote his three notes from the Tag wird kühl again and again, let me play you the climax of the first movement, which is actually the beginning of the recapitulation section in a movement that is, shall we say, slightly unusual. Never requotes the main theme, but this introductory theme does come again in the climax. Please adjust your senses, this is going to be loud. Especially put a red box around the four-fold repetition of the three-note theme from Der Tag wird kühl. Without going into details, the other movements of the symphony continue to use this theme all the way through. So that's how it happens. But that's the only time, as far as I can see, that Zemlinsky made any serious use of cryptography. But nevertheless, it was quite clear that there's a lot of there are a lot of things going on behind the scenes in his music, and it made me very inquisitive. I never understood them. Now, you see, so many of these pieces, I can go off this presentation again because I have nothing to illustrate here. So many of his pieces have a theme, or a motif of just three notes. In his basic form, it's D, E, G. Kirill, you've played, I believe, the clarinet trio.
Yes, I have.
You find it begins D, E, F, and then the next bar, D, E, G, exactly the same pitches at the beginning of the second string quartet, and the fourth string quartet, many other places. And also the same theme appears in other transpositions. And I spent a long time wondering, how does this work? Why are these three notes? Now, one of his pupils gave the game away a little bit, Rudolf Stefan Hoffmann, his name was, when he described the inversion of those three notes as Zemlinsky's motif of the world. Ba-da-dum. Motif of the world. He writes it in an article to celebrate Zemlinsky's 50th birthday. These things are meant to be kept secret, you see. Stefan Hoffmann had been a pupil of Zemlinsky, and he knew all about this. So I said, well, how do these three note motifs come about? The one, the DEG, and the other, its inversion. Has it got anything to do with the family name? I think it's notable, you see, that the mother's side was Semo, S-E-M, and the Zemlinsky side was originally S-E-M, Zemlinsky with an S. And I was wondering if that had anything to do with it, or if the actual letters DEG was spelling out some kind of a message. But none of that actually happened. And where does this come from?
I did it.
Those that
want to see it again in flesh. But yes, indeed, those are the first four.
There's actually so much more than those that little theme here to talk about. But maybe another time. Let me see if I can share my. Here we go again. This one. With music, yes. Right. Just a sec. I'm another new to this PowerPoint business. That's the symphony we just heard. So now, there was another mystery as well, which was Zemlinsky's date of birth. I just put it on the screen. Was the 14th of October, 1871. But as from about 1898 onwards, when all these strange things started happening in his life, like he became a Freemason, he left the Jewish community, etc., he started putting it about that his birth date was the 4th of October, 1872. And one said, what on earth is, why did earth need to just make himself younger than he already was? He always looked very young, and was commented on when he took his bow at the end of Serena in Munich. They said this, it looked like a teenager coming on stage. He was very tiny as it was, and he was clean shaven almost all of his life, and he looked like a schoolboy. Why would he want to make himself younger? It didn't make any sense to me at all. And then one mulls these things over sometimes for years, and suddenly it occurred to me. Here's the one date of birth, the 14th of October, 1871, and the other one, the 4th of October, 1872. All he's done is take the one away from the 14 and added one to the 1871 to make it 1872. So I said, logically then, what is interesting to him is the sum, the so-called checksum of those numbers. And so it was a very quickly, after years of searching, it very quickly put it together. Here we come. The checksum is 23. And that happens to have been Berg's secret number, you know, Alban Berg's secret number, 23. But Zemlinsky goes further, because the checksum of 2 and 3 is 5. And so we come to the fact that his secret number, his guide, shall we say, to good fortune, is the number 5. Everybody, like in those days, dabbled in this kind of numerology. And of course, in Zemlinsky's case, having been born on the 14th of a month, the 1 plus 4 also led to 5. So he was obviously, said to me, I'm a particularly, shall we say, a cosseted person, a person who's been taken in the arms of fate or predestination, whatever it is, and they've given me these wonderful numbers. 1 and 4 leads to 5, and 2 and 3 leads to 5. I'm a 5 person. So he starts putting these things in his music. He starts signing his name, so to speak, with these numbers. One of the wittiest and crassest, actually, is his overture to the operetta, the Oppenball of Heuberger. Yeah, it was quite normal in those days for people to write down the hit tunes and the chorus numbers and so on, and then put the music into the hands of a professional, so to speak. What happens in Hollywood today all the time. Somebody has a few good ideas, gives them to a professional who works them out for full orchestra, makes them, if necessary, a symphonic development. Zemlinsky's service, for which he got very little money, but no credit at all, was to do this for certain composers of operettas, maybe an industrialist. In this case, Heuberger was a colleague, and he composed this fulminating overture to the Oppenball. It ranks, I would say, just about on the level with the famous Donna Diana overture of Resnicek as an orchestral showpiece. Unfortunately, not played very open. But the piece begins, and this is the joke, because the name Heuberger is written down as a composer. The piece begins with the DEG, 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 again and again and again. Zemlinsky signing his name, again and again. This is to say, you may think this is Heuberger, but it's me, Zemlinsky. Now, the key to this, or when, as I think, when he was living in Vienna in the 1930s, his second wife, Louise, came back from the library with this piece, this play by André Gide, translated into German. And he opens it, and the first thing he reads, written here, der sein Glück hält, soll sich gut verstecken, und besser noch sein Glück vor anderen, which I've translated slightly roughly into English. If luck is with you, hide yourself well, and better still, hide your luck from others. Let me just play you how that sounds in the opera. It's also rather loud, but here we go.
Thank you. Glück hält, soll sich gut verstecken. Und besser noch sein Glück vor anderen.
So that's what it's all about. I would love to talk about his use of twos and threes, 2, 3, 5. But there's so much that I think we'll... Oh, sorry, stop that. Accident. The point is that there's so much of it. One of the lovely things, the DEG is made up, if you count the semitones, the half tones, D to E is 2, and E to G is 3. So you get immediately 2, 3, and D to G is 5, 2, 3, 5 semitones. But if you look at those pitches on the scale of C major, there are also points 2, 3, and 5 of the C major scale, which is why the DEG melody is transposable. It's not fixed to the letters of the alphabet. It's fixed to the steps of the scale. And I think Zemlinsky, this is the only situation within the octave where this is the case, that the sum of the semitones is equal to the steps on the scale. It's a slightly technical thing, and it's easier to demonstrate over with a piano at your fingertips or with music in front of you, but that's how it works. And then the opposite, the inversion, is what Rudolf Stefan Hoffmann called the motif of the world. So I come to the conclusion that there's object and mirror image. The DEG may be the object, the motif of the world is the mirror image, so the DEG must be the motif of himself. I've called it that, the motif of the soul. Himself, and often enough in his music, you find the very subtle traces of himself combined with the world, sometimes in confrontation with the world, sometimes in despair at the world. All these things can be it's expressed in a certain way with these numbers, but to go into the 2 and 3 thing would lead too far. It would take hours, so I will jump, and I would just like to point to some of his amazing uses of the number 5. Before I do anything wrong, yes, here we have, this is a composition, Turmwächterlied, the song of the watchman in the tower, with a poem by Jens Peter Jakobsson, originally in Swedish, Opus 8, one of his finest songs, and it happens to be his longest song as well. E flat major, there's probably symbolism in the choice of the three flats as well, as there is in Mozart, and sorry, stop that. This thing has a will of its own. I want to play. What's happening here? Sorry.
No worries.
We rewind this one. So let's here we go. That's the first idea. You see can you see my mouse pointer?
Yes, yes, we can.
Yes, I'm E flat to B flat in the top, and E flat to A flat in the bass. One mirror image of the other. If you did what Brahms would do to something like this, and you just play the bass and the treble together, it sounds hideous. But what Zemlinsky does here in the song, let me just play it again, if I may. If I had a piano, it would be easier. He turns that confrontation of the bass and the treble into a beautiful ninth chord, and follows it with another ninth chord in the third beat. When he comes to writing The Mermaid, Die Seejungfrau, several years later, he works on this theme. The theme comes again. I'll just play it to you with the orchestra now, on very softly on the brass. And he actually identifies it in his manuscript as the motif of the immortal soul, der unsterblichen Seele. And if I can get this to play, no, I've got to wind back. Here we go.
One more time. You have to click.
Yeah. No, not playing at all. Here we go.
Yeah.
Yes, that's right. It later comes on full brass and fortissimo and so on as a great triumph. But this is where the mermaid sees her future as an immortal, as she knows she's going to have to lose her life. Let's not go into all the details of that story now, it'll take too long. But it's a very important moment in the middle of this wonderful piece. Now, if you take that motif of the immortal soul apart into three voices, you can see there's a fourth. There's a fifth, there's another fifth, and there's another fourth. The nice thing about the fourth in Zemlinsky's use of the number five is that the fourth comprises five semitones, or it's the inversion of the fifth, whichever you prefer. And if you take the chord, let me go back to this chord at the end of the bar, which comes twice. If you take that and you spread out the notes, you see it's five times the fifth. A flat, E flat, B flat, F, C, and the additional G at the top would make a sixth. And so we have this becomes a kind of mania with him, a five note chord of fifths. Let me go on, because this is Kleider machen Leute. Here he has taken the idea of the fifth and transformed it into something appropriate to the beginning of a comical opera. But it's still the same thing. It's like when Catholics cross themselves when they enter a church, it's like him putting a talisman around his neck to say, I'm just embarking on a huge opera. Let me put my five fifths in and it'll give me luck on the way. I think that's the kind of mentality behind it. Now, let's go on to the Tonberg, which is actually written before Kleider machen Leute. The beginning is very soft, I'm afraid. I hope it's audible. I put the music down as well. The main theme of Tonberg, which comes on the low horn. Now this theme, which comes throughout the opera, as I said earlier, Zemlinsky identified himself with the character of George the Dreamer. He saw it as an alter ego, was this misfortune, this guy who goes out into the world in search of the greatest adventure, the greatest success, and comes home to his original village, so to speak, with his tail between his legs, making a compromise with reality. But he uses this theme again and again. In the König Kandaules, written 30 years later, suddenly Kandaules, when he makes his first entrance, came to the exactly the same theme, but now clad in rich colors of rich harmonies, shall we say, in the strings. I just let it play on a little bit. And then this is how he hides things. This is Psalm 23. written in 1910. Now, watch out for the viola entry on the next page. I've put a red box around it. You can't hear it. These four notes, I'll put my mouse on them again. These three notes is your Gerger theme again, just the beginning of it, D, E, B natural. As if that might be coincidence, he then shows at the end of the psalm that it certainly is not a coincidence. I'm going to play on from the climax of the psalm. Be careful, it's very loud, and it's softly, very quickly, and I've indicated in the score with red boxes and numbers exactly what happens. No, I haven't. Next one. Oh, I've lost it. Wait a sec. Come back.
Don't.
Oh, here. Right. No. It's gone. Where's it gone? It's lost. Never mind. I'll tell you what happened. That the climax of the psalm. Everybody sings loud and so on. And in the background, there are five repetitions of this Gerger theme. Five. First of all, on trumpets and trombones in very quiet octaves, and at the end, a very mysterious version for woodwind alone. I'm sorry, I don't know where the slide got to, but it's gone. What I wanted to say, maybe it'll turn up later this evening, is going back to this picture I showed you earlier, I can't help in my mind. There's this wonderful music in the Psalm 23, scored for two harps, two flutes, two piccolos, cymbals, triangle, and pizzicato strings. And I can't help thinking back to this picture with the light streaming in through the stained glass window in the cupola of the synagogue, because Zemlinsky's three psalm settings, his only sacred compositions at all settings from the Old Testament. That's to say, although he parted company from the Jewish faith, he does return to it in moments of stress, anxiety, as a search for comfort. He played the organ in this synagogue, and on fest days it was indeed accompanied by two harps. We know that. In fact, we even named the names of the harpists. Let me just play the passage from the psalm again. Whenever I hear this music in the psalm, I think of this picture of the light streaming in through the windows, and I think that's what he's trying to tell us. A solemn procession of people dressed in rich robes and with instruments playing. That's a sort of imagination I associate with that. Let's move on, because I lost the piece of the other fives. Let's move on to the number 14. I just have a few things to say, and then I think we'll be through. Now, we come to the Chalk Circle, his last opera one, Der Kreidekreis. And this is one of the things that persuaded me that, despite what people have been telling me, my fascination with Zemlinsky's use of numbers, they said, you're crazy. It's completely made up. You have no business. You don't know anything about it anyway. This is a folder of sketches for the Kreidekreis. And he's written on the folder in big letters, Metaphysik der Zahl, the metaphysics of number. And at the top of the page is the name of an author, A. Rae. I searched the world for a book with this title, never found it. But a friend of mine in New York finally came in the University of Columbia Library on the right title of the book. And it's here, Die Demaskierung der Zahl, The Unmasking of Number, A Path to Success, by this Alexander Rae, who was also a fugitive from Europe, settled in New York, and set up business as a fortune teller and soothsayer, as it happens. And his exertions to explain all numbers from 1 to about 99 are so complex and so long-winded, and say, well, you can take these things too far as well. Zemlinsky certainly would have written that down. Somebody must have told him while he was working on the Zeitgeist, you should look at this book. If you're into numerology, read Alexander Rae. Maybe he did, I don't know. But the fact is, you will find in Rae's book, which I struggled to read all the way through, very little that will tell us anything more about Zemlinsky's music. But there it is. But what this is a double page of sketches from the chalk circle, and you can't see very clearly. Maybe it depends on the size of your screens and the resolution. But all the bars are numbered here. One, oh, beg your pardon. Sorry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. One, 1, 2, 3, and so he's put little pencil numbers through every bar here, and it's obviously because he's counting the bars very carefully. He's counting the bars, and then when you get to the printed vocals, the published score or orchestral score, he departs from his lifelong habit of using numbers put in at irregular intervals, rehearsal numbers. One every 10 bars or so, you put in a rehearsal number. Here he specifically asked the publishers to number the bars. Every 5 bars there's a number, 840, 845, 850, and so on. Now, this was, again, occurred to me sheerly by coincidence. There's a very lovely article on Zemlinsky and Oriental tradition by a colleague called Peter Revers, which he quotes the three pieces of music I'm going to show you. And I just happened to be idly looking through them, and I looked at the bar numbers. Let me just play you first. This is the point of this is the chalk circle has a theme in it, naturally enough, the circle theme. And this begins here on the C sharps and goes through Zemlinsky's circle theme. And the quirk about it is it only appears once in each act in its entirety. There are little fragments of it and variants of it, but naked as it is here. Now, I've done this on a synthesizer, I'm afraid, because otherwise on the commercial recording it's available, the circle theme is completely obscured by the spoken dialogue above it. So please excuse the horrible sound, but this is Zemlinsky's circle theme. Now, this is miles away from Wagner's ring theme, which is also supposed to be a musical depiction of a circle, or from the beginning of Liszt's Faust symphony, which is a long chain of augmented thirds, which is supposed to depict the circle in which Faust steps in order to summon up the spirit of Mephistopheles. Then Zemlinsky's circle theme is, in fact, built of two half circles, and each of those is split into two segments of their own. You have, first of all, what you might call the hieratic element of fourths and fifths. Well, actually, the second at the beginning. Here you have a fifth, another fifth, and then the second half, which is the human aspect, which is totally distorted with the major seventh and so on. And then the other half of the circle repeats this in inversion, as one half of the circle is obviously the inversion of the other half. That's the sort of argumentation behind it. And if I may draw your attention to this, it begins in bar 842. Now, in the second act, this is a weird one, Haitang, the heroine of the opera, has been forced to marry a rich man called Ma, and her brother comes up to her in the garden and says, Ma is a wicked person, he must be assassinated. And Haitang says, but I love him. Meanwhile, I've come to terms with my husband. I adore him and I would not like him to be married. So they reach a compromise. They say, we will draw up a circle on the grass. You will step, he says to her brother, you stand some way from the circle and throw your knife. If it lands within the circle, you may kill him. If it lands outside the circle, he lives. And what happens? He throws the knife and it lands exactly on the circle. And therefore, the circle theme here is split across the bar line. You see, it starts here on the F, it's split again. It's only half of the circle theme here, but I won't play it because it's not necessary. But I may draw your attention to the fact it begins on the upbeat to bar 428. It's a big point. It begins in bar 428. And in the third act, the theme appears more extensively again here, as it was in the first act, as I played to you, the entire theme. And I draw attention to the fact it begins at bar 1238. And it may seem a little far-fetched, but now I move on. And so we have the circle theme, 842, 428, and 1238. And in each case, the checksum is 14. Now, that I discovered surely by accident, and I'm sure if one knew how Zemlinsky's attitude to numerology was developed, he never told anybody about it. This is, you only can do it by looking and seeking and finding. There's probably far more in the score of the Zeitgeist, because by this time at the end of his life, his search for success, for good fortune, is getting quite desperate. And as I say, these extreme measures of numerological sort of incantation, the putting talismans around the neck of his score, so to speak, are an expression of extreme concern. And that's about all I have to say. This is Zemlinsky's grave. Let's just say he was buried, first of all, he was cremated. He was buried, first of all, in Westchester. And then the foundation, financed by his widow, arranged for the transference of the urn with the ashes to the central cemetery in Vienna, which is where this stands. And you may see here, it has the wrong date of birth. It says 1872. 1942. That plaque has meanwhile been changed, I'm glad to say. And the extraordinary thing, there are these five-sided figures, as if somebody had known. Now, I met the sculptor who designed this, he's from Prague, and I said, did you know about Zemlinsky and the number five? He said, no. He said, I just decided the five stations of his life, Vienna, Prague, Berlin, Vienna, New York. So that's a coincidence, if you like, but Zemlinsky himself said there is no such thing as a coincidence. Everything that happens to us, everything we experience, is preordained. So that's all I have for you, Kirill. If you want to ask any questions, I'll stop the slideshow now and see how we can go on.
Well, how brilliant. Thank you so much for... I think what is a definitive introduction, and not just introduction, but talk and explanation of Zemlinsky's life and some of the forces behind his musical thinking. And the music is so enticing, even the little bits that you played. We do have a question from Victor Nikora again, and thank you, Victor, and everybody else is welcome to ask questions. Now is the time. Victor asks, where would you say Zemlinsky picked up this interest in numbers and symbolism? Might Schoenberg, who I believe also had an interest in numerology, have had a hand in that?
It was very common in his generation, and in, particularly in Jewish circles, particularly amongst those Jews who had decided to leave the faith. Of course, it goes back basically to the study of Kabbalah.
Oh, Antony, I think now it's time to switch to your other camera, because I think, as you promised, the battery in that one.
Yes, the battery in that one has given up. My beautiful picture will now. Here we come. There we are.
Okay. Oh, it's still really good.
It's not as good as it has been. But at least this one can't run out of gas. What I would call it a layman's Kabbalah everybody played with it in those days. It was half the fun. Everybody counted up the letters in their name, the letters in their date, the numbers in their date of birth. That kind of, course, it's gone back as far as Bach, and well before. In the Middle Ages, you find music is full of numbers. It's nothing new. I think it's a certain mentality that you dabble. It's like contemplating your navel and counting the numbers that you can find in your navel. It's something about trying to build yourself up from outside forces, trying to explain yourself through outside forces. I don't think it was anything new, as I say, and it could well be also that he learned a lot about it from them, from the Freemasons. But as I say, they're a very good secret society, very able to keep their secrets themselves. And I'm sure there are many such mysteries in the world of Freemasonry, which are closed to the rest of us. Somewhere from there, I think, is where it comes from.
Yeah, well, I think it's of course dangerous also to provide psychological interpretations, but one could suppose that also this period after the First World War, leading up to the Second World War, there's also this sense among many creative artists, composers included, in trying to find order in the disorder, and much of the previous order having collapsed. So I think possibly even the renewed attraction also having dismantled tonality in the case of Schoenberg and Berg, this interest in finding other ways of making sense of the great soup of chaos that is our experience of the universe. If we didn't name Bartok yet, who in a very different way is also fascinated with numbers,
Fibonacci's and so on.
Yes, and I could point. I will paste this in the chat box. Those of you that missed that talk, but you just made me think of Samuel J. Kaiser's earlier talk when he talks about the mental life of modernism and talks about the hidden meanings that creators put in. And of course, as we see with Zemlinsky, on one hand you can appreciate his music without knowing this, but then of course the more one observes, the more one is guided by experts such as yourself, then we learn more things and more layers to appreciate in this artwork.
I'm glad you brought up the name of Schoenberg at exactly the right moment, because you see, one of the scandals of Zemlinsky's life was that Schoenberg was his closest friend and later became one of his sternest enemies. When he first appeared back on the scene, so to speak, those close to Schoenberg, Weber and Webern, said, "It's fine, but he lacks courage. He never breaks with tonality. He may write very complicated harmonies, but there's always a key signature. There's always a key, at least not necessarily a key signature, but always a key. Why doesn't he share with Schoenberg the jump into atonality? Why does he avoid that?" And then later on comes the question, 1923, Schoenberg introduces the 12-note system and begins to use it almost exclusively, and Zemlinsky simply cannot follow it, and they've become really for a long time extremely aggressive towards another. And the explanation, as was given to me by a colleague who actually was an expert for the composer Victor Ullmann. Now, what I'm talking about with Zemlinsky, all these numbers and letters and so on, is relatively small. Ullmann is completely full of it. Ullmann was not only a Freemason, he was actually from the same lodge in Prague as Zemlinsky, but an ardent follower of Rudolf Steiner. And they brought together many, many theories of number and color. I haven't even talked about Zemlinsky to the relationship to the color circles of Goethe and so, but that's a too large a theme to put in today. Anyway, so the idea is all these numbers, these fives and 14s and twos and threes and so on, the strange attributes of the C major scale, the number of semiquavers the number of semitones and so on. According to Zemlinsky, and much more vehemently approached by Victor Ullmann, these are attributes given to us by divinity, by powers beyond the human being. They're undeniable, they're indestructible, and they're God-given. And when he sees Schoenberg making his own numbers, a series from 1 to 12, and turning it upside down, turning it round and round, he says, this is blasphemy. Ullmann said it's blasphemy. Ullmann actually studied with Schoenberg, but he did not follow him into the 12-man system because he said this is as bad as any other kind of insult towards the God-given things which are our tools of the trade as composers. That was Zemlinsky's stance as well, but he never put it as forcibly as that.
In fact, Ullmann's melodrama, the Lieben Weisses Kornett Strilke, is being done, I believe, this week with Czech Philharmonic, with Simon Bischkov and Thomas Kvastov narrating. So speaking about coincidence, and that's a wonderful piece, of course, written Theresien. Yes. We have a very interesting question from George Livadas from Athens.
George.
He says, if we could go back to Zemlinsky's father for a while, I noticed that he wrote the history of the Turkish-Israelitische Gemeinde in Vienna. This would seem to indicate that the Sephardic community in Vienna originally came from the Ottoman Empire, and Zemlinsky's mother, of course, perhaps from such well-known Jewish centers like Istanbul or Salonika, George Livadas.
Yeah, they called themselves Sephardis, and most of them came from Turkey. And for that reason, that in Vienna, they were called the Turkish Israelite community. In fact, their patron was the Sultan of Turkey. And the occasion which is documented as Zemlinsky having played the organ in the synagogue was a special service for the birthday of Sultan Abdulhamid II. So many of them, in fact, were not Austrian subjects. They had Turkish passports and just lived in Vienna as, so shall we say, under the protectorate of the Turkish embassy.
That's so, so fascinating in how this history turns, and of course the fate of minorities in the Ottoman Empire is fascinating, and it turns incredibly tragic. And then the genocide and the Holocaust having a tragic echo themselves in the 20th century. So incredible interconnections. There's so much, I think, well, you have authored books on these people, and I think one could spend, and I'd like to spend much more time on all these topics with you. We didn't even get to quite cover Zemlinsky's interpretive abilities, but while you were speaking, I looked up, at least as a point of departure, Zemlinsky's complete recordings, a link that is now in your chat. So so one can look at him as a composer, as a conductor. One can read Antony's book, inspired by this incredible talk. And of course, explore the music in Antony's recordings and other interpreters. So you've given us, I think, a great gift of making this personality a tragic one and perhaps not ultimately successful, but so attractive also in that. And now for me, somebody that's much more present in flesh and bone, as Unamuno once said. And so I will definitely be exploring more of Zemlinsky's music, thanks to you.
That we look forward to.
Yes, and we've recently talked about
piano.
Well, but we've recently talked about that little piece for piano and three mimes that you and I discussed. So more to come on that. And I hope that, Antony, you agree to return and talk about Kurt Weill or Xenakis or really anybody and anything else that interests you, because the way you managed to tell the story, I think, interests everybody that that listens. So so I wanted to thank all of you. Thank you for the interesting questions, and most importantly, Antony, thank you so much for being with us and for this incredible seminar.
It's been an honor and a great pleasure. Thank you, Kirill, and I look forward to hearing you play some wonderful music again soon. I don't know how you find the time between practicing and playing concerts to do these seminars, but it's always a great pleasure to watch and listen.
Well, the joy for me is learning from people such as yourself and being in this community of many interested people that join us either live and then also later on the archive in the YouTube channel. By the way, here, for those of you, I think most of you are aware, but here's the link to the seminars that are archived, but you're always encouraged to join in live and invite your friends to come along. But for now, we'll continue wishing you and everybody lots of health and fulfillment and learning and more very soon. Thank you, Antony.
My pleasure. Thank you, Kirill.
Good night.